There's enough for everybody.
All right, Darren, it's time.
What? Say, Gary?
Send him up.
Yeah?
There's no count down in the back, that's why.
It's gonna get downloaded. Let you out. We show you the camera here, you say, what am I doing? Where'd Luke go? Where's Luke?
We're good.
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. How are you this morning? If you'd like to stand for the call to worship, we will read from Colossians chapters 12 through 14. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues put on in love, which binds them all together and in perfect unity. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you so very much for the opportunity to be in here this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your presence with us. We just pray now that you'll be with the services, be with each and every one in attendance, and just help us to receive something from your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We're going to take an opportunity to turn on our iPad here because it doesn't want to do it on its own. There it goes. And we'd like to lead you in the song number 160 in your hymnal. It's Are You Washed in the Blood? And this morning, let's sing the first and the second verse, and then we'll jump down to the fourth verse together. We're going to be celebrating communion a little bit later on in the service, and so we've chosen songs that reflect what communion means to us and such. And so if you would join us, let's sing together.
If you would take your bulletins, the responsive reading is found in your bulletin. I'll be the leader and you be the people. He forgives all your sin. He heals all your diseases.
He redeems your life from the pit.
For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his faithful love toward those who fear him. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him.
Pastor Jake is going to be coming in just a little bit to share with us about that compassion that we can have for one another based on the compassion that we've received from God himself. Another song that we'd like to lead you in. It's not in your hymnal. It's another one of those songs that's just a great hymn of the faith that didn't end up in our hymnals, and that is Grace Greater Than Our Sin. And so we've printed it and stuffed it in your bulletin for you so you have those words. Would you stand with us? Because we always sing better when we're standing. We recognized that last week when we couldn't be with you, and we were sitting in the living room on the couch, all nice and comfy. And I grabbed a hymnal so that I had the words to sing with you, but we noticed very quickly that I was singing here because I couldn't sing here when I was trying to sit on the couch. So if you're at home and you're live and you're going to sing with us, you might want to stand because it's a whole lot easier than sitting on the couch singing. I learned that one the hard way last week. Of course, I didn't get off the couch. I should say that, be honest. It was very comfortable just sitting there, but would you stand with us and let's sing this song together. Grace Greater Than Our Sin. Take an opportunity to pray with you this evening, both those of you who have gathered in the house of the Lord and those of you who are joining us on Facebook Live. There's a lot of things that are going on in our world today. I know many, as they were making their way into the church service this morning, had their masks on and just wanting to be a little extra careful as they're mingling with folks and such. And I've had my mask on most of the morning. Up here on the platform, it's a little easier to take it off, a little easier to sing without it on and such. But we want to just be praying for those in our community that have been affected by COVID and the latest uptick that's taken place. And I just lift up the workers that are working with them. Our schools are having a little bit of that kind of stuff happening. And teachers, Amy was on the line last night for about a half hour with one of our local teachers that comes to church here, and just some of the struggles that they're dealing with and the challenges that are there. And just want to lift them up. I know there's so many other things that we could be praying for, but these things tend to be pressing on our minds. The media is pretty good at keeping them right there in front of us. But we just want to lift them up and ask that God's grace would be greater than anything that is out there today. So would you join me in praying together? Lord God, we're just so grateful to have opportunity to worship you in whatever medium we find ourselves in today. Whether we're standing here in the service, here at Bentley Creek Wesleyan at this 8 o'clock service, and practicing our social distancing and our masks and keeping our hands clean and doing all the things that need to be done in order to protect ourselves and our loved ones, or we're watching at home online, God, thank you so much for the opportunity to be able to do that. We had a few snafus this morning with some of the live feed things and easy worship, and yet we were able to work that out and get those things taken care of so that we could project live and be able to minister to those that aren't going to be with us today and are just tuning in. And so, Father, we're so grateful that your hand is upon all this, and we just ask that you would continue to do so, that you would give the strength and the endurance that our teachers need and our healthcare workers need, and those that are spending days in retail and such and just covered in their masks the whole entire time that they're on their shift. And it can be very it can be very challenging. It can be very exhausting by the end of the day to have breathed through a mask the whole entire time, and especially when you're not used to it. And so, Father, we just want to lift them up and just ask that your grace, your mercy would be upon them, that you would give them an extra amount of strength that could only become from you, that they'd get to the end of their day and go, I'm not sure how I made it through that day. And then you would speak to their heart and say, it's because I love you and I wanted to help you today. And so, Father, I know there's many other needs that are representative of our congregation, and we want to just lift those up to you today, even though we may not name them. Father, each and every one of us are thinking of various things that are on our hearts and minds. And Father, we know that you are fully capable of meeting us at those needs. And Father, you have a way of answering them in such ways that just blow our minds. And so, Father, we just, as we're thinking about them and lifting them up to you individually, here and abroad, Father, we just pray that you would meet us at our needs, and that, Father, you'd speak to our hearts about how we might be a part of your answer in those situations, how we might be your hands and your feet along the way. And so, Father, as we continue to make our way towards a time in your word, I pray that you would just bless Pastor Jake and speak through his the words that you've given him and the scriptures that he's put together in order to share compassion through the mask. And then, Father, as we turn our attention to reminding ourselves once again of the great sacrifice that you gave on our behalf, and we partake of communion once again, Father, would you prepare our hearts for that as well, that we might just have a wonderful time of worship today in all the elements that bring it together. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. One more song we'd like to sing with you before the scripture lesson is read, and we turn things over to Pastor Jake. It's number 169 in your hymnal. It's There Is Power in the Blood. And this time, let's sing the first verse, and then we'll sing verses 3 and 4. So verses 1, 3, and 4 together.
Thank you.
people said?
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. In keeping with the traditions of the church, please stand with me for the reading of the gospel. Today's scripture reading is taken from Mark 1, 40 through 45. Then a man with leprosy came to him and, on his knees, begged him, "If you are willing, you can make me clean." Moved with compassion, Jesus reached out his hand and touched him. "I am willing," he told him. "Be made clean." Immediately the leprosy left him and he was made clean. Then he sternly warned him and sent him away at once, telling him, "See that you say nothing to anyone, but go and show yourself to the priest and offer what Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them." Yet he went out and began to proclaim it widely and to spread the news, with the results that Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but he was out in deserted places and they came to him from everywhere. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning. It's not often I get to be up here and talk with all y'all. All y'all. So Pastor Rob has been going through this series called No Mask Can Stifle Your Smile. And we've talked about how patience through the mask. We've talked about generosity through the mask. We've talked about love through the mask. Today we're going to talk about compassion through the mask. We're keeping with that theme of Colossians 3, 12 through 14 that you heard earlier. And my dad has a rule whenever we're out on the boat that if we see someone stuck, we have to stop and help them. The reason being is because we've been that stuck boat many times, stuck out in the water with nowhere to go. One of my favorite stories of a time that this happened to us, I unfortunately was not on the boat, but it's still one of my favorite stories. My brothers and both of their girlfriends were out on the boat. And we're on Long Lake, which if you know where Long Lake is, it's in the Adirondacks, not a very big lake. They got stuck out on the water. And so my oldest brother, Chris, he's out, he's in the back of the boat. He's trying to troubleshoot it, trying to see if he can get it started. My other brother, Nate, he's sitting there. He's waiting because he knows if Chris can't get the boat started, he has to row. And Nate's girlfriend at the time was dramatic, to say the least. You all know those people who like to be a little dramatic. And so they're in a lake, not a very big lake. They're not sinking. The engine's just not wanting to start back up. They can row to shore. It'll take a while to get back, but they're fine. And she is freaking out. And in her midst of freaking out, she decides that the way that they're going to get back to shore the fastest is to flag down an airplane. Which is a little ridiculous. And so they get back eventually because somebody came by, they saw they were stuck, they gave them a tow back, and it took a while, but somebody saw them. And they like my dad, know what it was like to be stuck in the middle of the lake and have to row back to shore. So somebody came by and they gave them a tow, and they get back, and Nate gets off the boat, and he's just annoyed. And he goes, he's like, "I don't want to talk about it." So Chris comes up and he goes, "Y'all are not going to believe what Nate's girlfriend did." And he tells us this story. Now, we're going to circle back to that story in a little bit and the compassion that was shown by the man who decided to tow him in. But first I want to talk a little bit about compassion. It's one of those words that we all know the meaning of without really knowing the meaning of compassion. Right, we could all throw out synonyms for the word kindness, forgiveness, empathy. But the definition of compassion, dictionary definition, is this: sympathetic pity and concern for the suffering or misfortunes of others. Mark 1, verses 40 through 45 are a story of Jesus showing compassion. It was a man who he didn't need to show compassion towards, but he showed compassion anyways. But I should pause here for a second. Some of you, depending on the translation that you're reading out of, You're going, Pastor Jake, it doesn't say compassion. It says Jesus was indignant with the man. Indignant and compassion do not mean the same thing. Indignant is very different. However, scholars say that Jesus was compassionate towards the man, but when it refers to him as indignant, he's being indignant towards the disease itself, towards the leprosy that was wreaking havoc on this man's life. To be indignant with something means to be upset with something or to see it as unfair treatment. Now, this is important. Psychologists say that there are three things that evoke the emotion of compassion within us. So the first thing is that the experiences that people are facing evoke serious feelings within us. So first, we have to feel bad for them. There has to be this evoking of serious emotions within us. Secondly, the sufferer's troubles not be self-inflicted, that they be result of an unjust fate. And that's why it's important that Jesus was indignant with that disease, because he was seeing it as an unfair treatment, as an unjust fate towards that man. The third thing is, we must be able to picture ourselves in that same predicament. So Jesus sees this unfair treatment of the man, and he decides that it's not something self-inflicted, it's not something that this man caused on himself, and it evokes this serious feeling within him, and he can see himself in that man's shoes. The man walking up to Jesus was breaking a lot of Jewish customs and a lot of Jewish rules about being unclean. He should have been living on the outskirts of society, nowhere near people. And the fear of being ousted by the community, not to mention the fact that Jesus could have caught the disease and faced death from the leprosy, should have meant that he should have had nothing to do with this man. In fact, most people would have had nothing to do with this man. Any biblical account that we see of leprosy being cured is only through miraculous intervention. There was no cure for it. But this man shows faith. He ignores the Old Testament laws, he ignores the customs, and he comes up to Jesus. And I love what he says, because what he says is a statement of faith. He says to Jesus, "If you are willing, you can cleanse me." There's no doubt. It's not if you can heal me, you will. Not if you are able to heal me, you will. It's if you are willing. He already knows what Jesus can do. And he says, "If you are willing to heal me." So let me ask you, when it comes to compassion, are you willing? If we're not willing to be compassionate, then there's no point in even talking about it. We have to be willing to first be compassionate. And we're going to talk a little bit about why that's not as easy as we think it should be. We've talked about why Jesus shows compassion to this man, because he can see himself in his shoes. But how he heals him is also important. When it comes to Jewish culture, it's all about things that are unclean making other things unclean. And so if you got certain diseases, if you touched a dead body, you would be considered unclean or defiled, and there would be certain things that you'd have to go through to be considered ceremonial clean again. But Jesus touches this man with leprosy. This should have made Jesus unclean by Jewish standards. But Jesus is showing something. Jesus is showing that through him, it's not about the unclean making the clean unclean, which is a little confusing, but Jesus reverses the direction of purity, and through Jesus, the unclean are made clean. Where before it was about the unclean making everything else unclean, through Jesus, the unclean are made clean. Christians are some of the most compassionate people I know. Christians are some of the least compassionate people that I know. And we're all guilty of this, especially within our circles of influence. We have a cookie-cutter Christian that we say, this is what it is, these are the people that I care about, these are the people I'm going to be compassionate to, look at me, oh, I'm so nice to these people. But then you start going outside of our circles a little bit, and it gets harder and harder and harder. And to an extent, it's easy when you see the person stuck on the middle of the lake, to give them a tow. It's easy when you see a person on the side of the road to help them change out a tire. It's harder when you know enough about that person to be like, oh, well, they probably deserved it. Or, oh, well, they're doing this, and they got themselves in that situation. Too often, when we know a little bit about someone, we find ourselves doing that because they're not who we think they should be. Sometimes we mark them as dirty or unclean, like the Jews would have done. So are you willing to get dirty? Are you willing to go and to work with people who aren't necessarily like you? Jesus was compassionate towards the man and yet indignant with the disease that wreaked havoc on him. We should show compassion to those around us, no matter how mean they are to us, no matter how inconvenient. This man came up to Jesus as Jesus was going to do other things. Notice it doesn't say Jesus is walking by waiting for this man to come up to him. Jesus was going to do other things, and this man comes up and stops him. When I was an RA at SWU, we had a rule. It wasn't really a rule, but we had a saying that was, live life interrupted. And it was just, people are going to be people, and they're going to need things, and it's going to be inconvenient at times. I could be driving over to the church I was working at when I was in college and get a call, hey, something's going on, turn back around and go back. It's inconvenient to be compassionate. It's inconvenient to care. But think about how your compassion could show someone Jesus, because through Jesus, the unclean are made clean. In Exodus, God is speaking to Moses on Mount Sinai. After he has just smashed the first set of tablets, and God says this to Moses in Exodus 34, 6 through 7. Then the Lord passed in front of him and proclaimed, Yahweh. Yahweh is a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in faithful love and truth, maintaining faithful love to 1,000 generations, forgiving wrongdoing, rebellion, and sin. God is a compassionate God. And yet, despite God showing the Israelites compassion over and over and over again, they continually turn away from him. And they fail to show that same love and compassion to those around them. That narrative continues through the entirety of the Old Testament. In the book of Isaiah, God's compassion comes up several times. And we begin to see it pointing towards a restoration of Israel, of redemption of God's people because of his compassion. Fast forward to the New Testament, and Jesus comes onto the scene. Fully God and fully man. Remember what the third thing that psychologists said we needed to experience compassion? We must be able to picture ourselves in the same predicament. God took this to a whole new step. Jesus came and experienced firsthand what it was like to be human, to be tempted, to feel loss, to face death. And it's because we are made in the image of God that we can love like him, and it also means that we can be compassionate like him, even when it costs us everything. In Isaiah, God had promised the Israelites that because of his compassion, he would never leave them, that he would save them. And he did that through Christ's death on the cross. So, are you willing to be compassionate? Are you willing to go out of your way when it's inconvenient? Are you willing to deal with people who are dirty or unclean? To set aside our cynicism? Are you willing to let emotions be evoked in you that you are willing to help people? Are you willing to put yourself in other people's shoes? It wasn't convenient, and it wasn't easy. And it cost him his one and only son. But God's compassion for us was so great that it was worth the cost. Before I wrap this up, I'm going to invite the worship team back up to do their song. And then we're going to wrap this up and move into communion.
switch out a few things here real quick. We'd like to lead you in a, hold on. I'm gonna walk off the stage and come back, there we go. We'd like to lead you in a worship hymn just prior to communion, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. It's number 130, I believe, in your hymnal. And we'd like to just lead you in all four verses together. Would you stand as we sing?
Today, as we take part in communion, I want you to think about God's compassion for us. The compassion represented in the elements and how we could show that same compassion to others. It requires getting dirty, it requires sacrifice, and it isn't easy. Yet we're called to do it. Now, in the Wesleyan Church, we observe an open communion, which means that you can be a member here or not of any Wesleyan church to take part. But we do ask that you are walking in fellowship with God and in love and harmony with your neighbor, and that you do true and earnestly repent of your sin and intend to lead a new life in God. So go ahead and take off that first tab, the top one. Jesus and the disciples were in the upper room, and Jesus, knowing full well the punishment that he was going to endure, he ate the Passover with them, filled with compassion for those around him, including Judas, who was going to betray him. And he took the bread, and he broke it, and he said, This bread represents my body, which will be broken and shed for you. And they ate. go ahead and peel off that second tab. Then he took the cup, and he passed, and he said, "This cup represents my blood, which will be shed for you." And they drank. Let's pray. Dear God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the people here. God, we thank you for the compassion that you've shown for us. And God, may that ignite compassion within us to show to others in the same way that you've shown it to us. Father, help us to be willing. Help us to see that it may not be easy, but that it's what you want. Help us to recognize that that through you, the unclean can be made clean through the compassion that we show to others. In Jesus' name, amen. Benediction for today comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 3 through 4. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. You're dismissed.